How come the amplifier has heavy distortion when I open up the volume knob completely? It's one of these questions about volume control that I come across very often. So it's time to shine some light on the subject. In many home appliances, a knob sets the level of operation. A knob on a furnace sets the heat of the furnace. The central heating thermostat sets the heat in the room. The light dimmer sets the brightness of a lamp and so on. And they all do it in a predictable way. And although the volume gets up when you turn the volume knob of an amplifier or AV receiver clockwise, you might get another loudness at the same setting. The simple reason is that the volume knob has no absolute relation to the loudness. To understand that, we have to understand the function of the volume knob in an amplifier. Don't be afraid, I'll keep it simple. To electronics engineers, I am aware that there is much more to say on the amplifier technique, but I don't, to keep it simple. Let's look at an imaginary amplifier by function blocks and start with the inputs, in this case four. Those are connected to an input selector that lets you choose one of the inputs. Then follows a first amplifier stage, a so-called potentiometer, aka volume control, and a second amplifier stage that feeds the power amplifier. In a stereo amplifier, there are two of these circuits, one for the left and one for the right channel. And of course, the input selector and the volume controls are coupled between the channels. Often pre and power amplifiers are integrated in the same housing, but the preamplifier, the part in the drawing here, can be in a separate housing from the power amplifier. As we have seen, the volume control is a so-called potentiometer, which has nothing to do with testing Viagra. It is a variable resistor, and as you might understand, a variable resistor can only attenuate a signal. Okay, let's go back to the schematics. Let's first drop the right channel. Since both channels work the same, it suffices to look at only one. This gives me room for a so-called gain structure graph. Sounds difficult, but it just shows the voltages in the stages of the preamp. How does it work? Well, let's assume we connect a CD player that outputs 2 volts at the loudest signal, as defined by the Sony and Philips Redbook specifications. In audio, we like to work in dBs, and 2 volts equals plus 6 dBV. Since the input selector has no active elements, the level stays at plus 6 dBV maximum. If we then assume that the first amplifier stage is used for buffering and has no gain, the voltage stays at plus 6 dBV. When the volume knob is turned completely clockwise, there will be no attenuation, leaving the level at plus 6 dBV. The second amplifier stage we also set to 0 dB amplification, for then the output level of the preamp is equal to the input level of plus 6 dBV. To give you some feeling with the consequence of this, let's assume that a 60 watt power amplifier follows that needs plus 6 dBV to produce full power. Depending on the efficiency of the speakers, this will lead to a very high to ear-shattering high sound level, and thus this level is hardly ever used. But I need this to make my point later on. Amplifier manufacturers need to take into account that there still are people using analog equipment like turntables, FM tuners, tape recorders and cassette decks. Let's for now focus on the tape recorder, where with digital equipment the loudest level is easily defined, the point where all 16 or 24 bits are once. With analog, that's a bit more complex. There a nominal output level is specified. Above that, there often is at least 10 dBs of headroom or more. TEAC tape recorders use 350 millivolts nominal, which is minus 10 dBV. If we then take into account a headroom of 10 dBs, we get peaks at 0 dBV. Using the same settings as before, you'll see that the output to the power amplifier is at 0 dB, 6 dB lower than when using the CD player. As a result, you are no longer able to use the 60 watts of the power amplifier. What the designer can do is set the first amplifier stage to 6 dB gains. Now the full 60 watts again is at our disposal. But what happens when we switch back to the CD player? Due to the 6 dB gain we introduced in the first amplifier stage, the output voltage when using the CD player goes to plus 12 dBV, and that might be more than the power amp can handle. What we then have to do is turn back the volume knob so that it attenuates the signal by 6 dB. Let's now look what happens when we connect an old quad FM3. This tuner outputs only 100 mV nominal, which is minus 20 dBV. We again add 10 dB headroom and thus set the highest level at minus 10 dBV. Leaving the amplifier setting as it was, we see a maximum preamp output of minus 10 dBV. We can reduce the attenuation of the volume control to 0 dB, but then we still are 10 dB short. So the designer needs to add an extra 10 dB gain in the first amplifier stage to a total of 16 dB gain. If we switch back to the CD player, we see that we have to increase the attenuation by the volume control to 16 dB and hope that the designer has dimensioned the first amplifier stage with sufficient headroom. In practice, the volume control will be in a much lower position since you don't need to drive the power amp up to 60 watts for normal listening. Average power usage under living room conditions is rather around 1 watt. By the way, the difference in power between 60 and 1 watts is just below 18 dB. When using a digital source that outputs Redbook specified 2 volts and you want to play the loudest, the volume control will be in a low position. Using an average analog source that has lower output level will lead to a higher volume control setting for the same listening level. When using an old, even lower output analog source, the volume control needs to be at an even higher setting for the same listening level. Then what about the turntable? Phono cartridges have an even lower output, from a few millivolts for moving magnet cartridges to a few tenths of a millivolt for moving coil types. They therefore need an extra amplifier stage, which will include the also needed RIAA correction curve. Again, there is a wide variety of cartridges and a large range of output voltages. Simple pre-preamps, as they are called, offer the choice of moving magnet, MM for short, or moving coil, MC for short. More sophisticated pre-pres offer impedance, capacitance and gain settings with the goal to have the output voltages of the pre-pre at full modulation equal to other sources. The pre-pre can be integrated into the preamp or amp, but there are also external units available. So we have seen that the volume knob settings vary depending on the hardware used. And if that's not enough, the program material can vary in loudness too. That already started with reel-to-reel tapes that could vary up to 6 dB in maximum output level. Looking at vinyl, cutting speeds and thus the output voltage of the cartridge varied. And then there is the loudness war that reduced the distance between the average and peak level, making a track of an album sound louder at the expense of transparency. Anyone that uses streaming players know the option to automatically compensate for perceived loudness. If the player doesn't compensate for it, or if you don't want it to compensate, you have to vary the volume control between tracks and/or albums. The efficiency of loudspeakers also has its influence. Very high efficient loudspeakers can produce 105 dB sound pressure level at 1 meter and 1 watt power. Very low efficiency speakers might produce as little as 83 dB sound pressure level. The average efficiency is considered to be 89 dB SPL. 105 dB SPL is 16 dB higher level, while 83 dB SPL is 6 dB lower. In total, 22 dB difference between speakers, while the source and the volume control are not changed. It might be clear by now that the position of the volume control is no accurate indication of the perceived acoustical loudness. So don't think that when your volume control is at 25% you have 75% power reserve. It might be, but chances are you don't. And you shouldn't express audio in percentage anyway, but in dBs. See my video The dB Explained. The volume control sets the overall amplification of the amplifier by attenuating the signal. Ideally, all sources should have the same output level, and that includes program materials. The reality is that this isn't the case despite the standards for CD players and loudness of program material. And although it's not optimal, it's workable. Which is a fine conclusion to end with. Thank you for watching. There will be another video next Friday, as always at 5 PM Central European Time. If you don't want to miss that, subscribe to this channel or follow me on the social media so you'll be warned when new videos are out. If you like this video, give it a thumbs up. Many thanks to all that support this channel financially. It keeps me independent and thus trustworthy. If you also feel like supporting my work, the links are in the comments below this video on YouTube. I'm Hans Beekhuizen, thank you for watching and see you in the next show or on the hbproject.com. Whatever you do, enjoy the music.